Hey everybody, welcome in. Tonight we are hanging out with Miss Jess Santos, and we are going to be talking more Milky Way photography as we get ready for the NightScaper Conference that is coming here in less than 2 months. If you haven't gotten your passes, if you haven't joined us virtually at least over at Royce Bear's NightScaper Conference, then make sure you go to nightscaper.com right now. Tell your friends and family that are also wanting to learn about Milky Way photography and join us there. Yes, the in-person stuff is completely full, sold out. We are down in Kanab, Utah, and those of us who are there locally and close are going to enjoy beautiful skies and playing around with our cameras as well, but you can take all of the knowledge and all of the learning with you by joining us virtually. So just go down here, right there, nightscaper.com, check it out, join us at the conference. Make sure you do, because there's going to be 40 plus people who are going to teach us about Milky Way photography. And if you can't find 1700 tips, I'll be surprised. You'll come out of there with more than 1,000 pieces of information that you can learn, even if you think you know everything. In fact, tonight's presentation is going to be for all of you well-practiced Milky Way photographers, nearly a master, because you're thinking, I've really got this down. I can capture a Milky Way image. I can capture, you know, the stars and the Milky Way. They look great. I got an okay composition with the foreground, and I'm liking it. But there's more that you could do, and you're going to learn from the quality that Miss Jess Santos has. Learn from the artistic touch, the extra effort in Photoshop that comes from her work that shows up in her images. And you're going to find out, okay, I've mastered exposing a Milky Way, but I haven't mastered Milky Way photography yet. And so this is going to be a night where you're going to have some ideas. You thought, oh, wow, okay, yes, I want to be a part of that. So to get us started, I'm going to go into this quick introduction to her work, and then we'll bring in the star of the night, Miss Jess Santos. So here we go. Let's start off with this. Oh man, how many of you have made your own time lapse before? Well, there's a lot of work that goes into making the final video look awesome, but it's actually very easy to do, and I hope that you'll do it more. Just watching Brad Goldpaint's time lapses last week, watching Jess Santos's time lapses tonight, it makes you excited to get out there and see the Milky Way. Well, let's bring her in. Let's bring in our guest tonight, Miss Jess Best. If you haven't signed into Instagram yet and logged into her, there she is at Jess, Miss Jess Best. Join us, and here she is. Hey, Jess. Oh, I went to your video again. Hey, Jess Santos. I went quickly to your time lapses. So welcome in. Hey, how's it going?
Thank you. It's going good.
You're finally allowed to make a noise. You've been sitting in the background, hanging out. You and I haven't really had a chance to hang out and talk much, but your photography is something that blends the landscape photography love of purple of Aaron Bobnick with Milky Way photography. And it's so hard not to be jealous every time I see your images. How long have you been doing this?
I've been doing it for about 5 years now.
5 years now? Yeah. Oh, man. So then when you get into something like this and you're doing for 5 years, right off from the start, did you play around with all the noise, cleaning up the noise and fixing your composition in Photoshop? Or did you start out like, you know, me and others who are just single image Milky Way, capture it and see how it turns out?
I started off as single image with either low level landscape lighting or light painting. And then about 2 years in, I started to play around with blending blue hour foregrounds with the night sky. And I just fell in love with the look of it a lot more than the light painting. So it just took hold, and I haven't shot a single image since.
Well, this is something that I love, and you polish it like no other. In fact, a while ago, I had a guest on. Oh, I use Alt Tab, and it showed up in the screen. I just saw it over there. Sorry about that. I can't use Alt Tab. I got to remember that. I wanted to check out on the chat since the chat wasn't showing up to see where everyone's coming from. We've got Singapore, Germany. We've got Missouri. We have Las Vegas, Nevada. Everyone's hanging out and talking. And so you guys probably can share the same feeling that one of my workshop attendees had. It was a situation where she asked, okay, she was capturing her image. She was getting a great shot. I'm really keen on the settings for the capture. But then when it came to post-processing, she really wanted to do more, and she asked, okay, what do you do typically? I'm like, oh, well, I'm not the right person to ask. I am literally terrible at this because I love it simple. I love it very easygoing, and I just use the gear that I have, and I flow with it, right? And I'm like, okay, if you're thinking about playing around with it more and really polishing your image, there's two people that I would recommend you look up that have great Milky Way photography. And those two people were Joshua Snow and Jess Santos. Yeah. And I'm sitting there with this person in the workshop in the beginning of the year, and I don't hear from her from the end. The pandemic begins, and now I'm wondering, okay, is she doing anything else? I go out to Alabama Hills, and I'm out there hanging out by Mobius Arch, and lo and behold, there's Mo. She's right there. And not only is she there, but she's there in a workshop with the two people I recommended that she learned from, Jess Bess, or Miss Jess Santos, and Joshua Snow. So she, yeah, I'm
she's
sure
one
has
of my favorites.
She is awesome. It's just she needed to go further. And that next step, it was easy to recommend you guys to teach her. Your experience with Mo, did she love the post-processing? Because I felt her kind of go, yeah. Oh, I wanted to do more. Did you guys get that sense when you taught her?
Yeah, most definitely. She and I are kind of kindred spirits because we both do graphic design. So we're both familiar with Photoshop and Lightroom and all that graphic design stuff. So bringing that into photography is, I think, where the magic happens.
Yes. When you go through and see your images, you're obviously your biggest critique. You look at your own stuff and say, ah, this sucks. Ah, this is dirty. This is noisy. This is a boring foreground. When you want to give someone who's completely brand new a tip on how to get something that looks as polished as your entire frame, do you have like off the cuff one or two tips that you like to share the most?
I would think the most important is composition is always key. So play around and try and find as many compositions as you can, and then sit down and focus on one and really fine tune it. But make sure to check out different angles, different like wider or more zoomed in, whatever the case may be with what you're shooting. But like, figure out your composition prior to settling in, and then just settle down and really focus on that. I think that's first and foremost. And then the second kind of comes as you do it a little bit more, but being able to imagine what the image is going to look like in the end will go great lengths for how you shoot, what you need to capture in camera, so that when you get home and sit down to edit it, you're not missing any pieces and you know exactly how you want to go into editing it with a plan.
So then when you're thinking about that and you're on location, there's two things I usually experience. Composition paralysis, where it's like all of these look either good or all of these look terrible and I'm not sure which one is going to be great. And the second thing I run into is it's very often, and I notice this in my own photography and everyone's photography, you get stuck with what you liked the most and you forget what's still in your frame. How do you avoid getting those distracting elements that you didn't really want in your composition?
It's really, really, I will spend, for example, if I go out and I photograph cacti, I will spend probably an hour and a half really fine tuning what's in my frame. And we're talking about millimeters on a tripod, looking through and really analyzing everything before I actually take the shot. So I get there like 3 hours ahead of shooting so I can have that time. And then once I dial it in, I get to sit with nature and just wait for it to unfold before me. So like, just really taking the time to fine tune it in your camera is like just really important.
And how do you handle those dark corners when you can't see them at night?
Well, so I shoot mostly at blue hour. And if I'm going out in the middle of the night to shoot, scout it ahead of time, make sure that you know exactly what you want, take test shots. And I also have a little cheat because I'm a Sony user. I kind of have a bright monitoring. So So it's kind of like night vision goggles for my camera. Right? So I don't really deal with able to see in the dark. But for those of you who don't have that, just scouting ahead of time and really making sure what you want to shoot, when you want to shoot it, like, because light is really important too. So different times of blue hour, sunrise or sunset, is really going to make or break your image as far as light goes. So dialing those things in ahead of time, like the day before, then you go out with a plan. You know exactly what you want and you can sleep on it overnight or for the few hours you get to sleep until Milky Way comes up.
For the few hours, right?
Yeah, for the 3 hours you get.
I was just showing them while you were talking your time lapses again, just underneath you, your voice. And as you look at those, I just, before we go in your presentation, I have to ask, I see that you favor the still frame foreground and the time lapse in the background. Any mm-hmm. reasoning why, or what was your favorite about that?
So it kind of started off with, I don't know which one you showed, but the boot arch one. So the one with boot arch, it's kind of the arch on, well, I guess they're both arches with them on the right. Anyways, one of them, I messed up my depth of field or my distance from my foreground. And so the arch was actually blurry and I was really bummed about it because the Milky Way was so great. So I actually dropped in a blue hour foreground in it. And I just like the look of it because you can see so much. I feel like you get this nice, soft, dreamy quality when you use a blue hour foreground versus light painting. It's a little bit more harsh and contrasted. So I just tried that and ran with it. Now, when I get into motion time lapses on a slider, which I do have and I am playing around with, it's going to be more complicated and who knows if I can actually pull that off, but we'll see.
Yep. Changing to something new like that, introducing new technical gear, introducing new techniques, those will all turn us back into noobs. So let's go into focusing on what you do best. Today's presentation, I'm going to go ahead and jump out and let you set up your screen so that everyone can get ready to go. Let's have you share your screen with me so we can see your presentation. But everyone who's here about to learn from Miss Jess Santos. Now, I'm saying Miss now because of your Instagram. It's at Miss Jess Bess. Bess is not her last name. Nope. Santos is her last name. What's the reason for Bess anyway? What is behind that?
Well, my best friend in college, she used to call me Miss Justess and it just stuck and I stuck with it. Awesome. It just rhymes, I guess.
Well, it's better than the nickname one girl gave me in junior high called Fuzzy Wuzzy. That was before lost all my hair to the curse of growing past 21 years old. Stupid. So let's get going. Let's get ready. If you haven't shared it with your friends, share it now because we're getting into the meat of this and we're going to learn from Miss Jess Bess or her real name, Jess Santos, right now. Let's go ahead and hang out. Okay, we're ready to go with your screen. You're good to go?
Sounds great.
Awesome. Here we go. So it's all yours and my little camera is going away.
Great. Well, we're going to work on blending our sky with our blue hour foreground. And I have this blue hour foreground shot in Joshua Tree, and it's actually technically not a blue hour. This was shot at sunrise, right before there was direct light on the rock. And this is because in this area, you're only allowed to be there from sunrise to sunset unless you have a special permit. So therefore, because of that, I shot this at sunrise, like right at sunrise, and I had to do a composite because I couldn't shoot the Milky Way and leave my tripod there because it's not allowed. So I just wanted to talk a little bit about the composition before we dive into the actual Photoshop, and I'm going to go over way more in detail at the NightScaper Conference, but I just wanted to point out the fact that I'm normally known for shooting with my wide angle lens. And for this, I actually opted for my 24-70 because I really wanted to step back and create this scene. The Milky Way lines up right about here, if you can see my cursor moving. So I wanted to have this little human element, this little stargazer standing on this great rock in Joshua Tree, but it's Joshua Tree, right? So I wanted to include a little bit of the tree. So I had to step back and zoom in a little bit to get rid of the other chaotic elements that are going around out here, like bushes and other little shrubs. So I just wanted to point that out. When you're looking for composition, don't always stick to what you use all the time, because that might not work for the scene you're going for. And in this case, I don't use my 24 to 70 that often. I'm usually on the 12 to 24, but I really needed that extra little zoom. I think this was shot at like 31 or 33 millimeters. So play around with that when you're looking in terms of composition, and it might help you find something a little more magical and bring that vision you have in your head out in the image. So let's dive into the actual editing portion of this. I start off by importing all my photos into Lightroom, and I use this mainly for cataloging, but I do a lot of global adjustments. And you can see I've already edited this. I'm just going to reset this just so you can see what it looked like prior. And I zoomed in because I felt like this rock was distracting out here. I wanted the eye to go to the person and not this rock. My eye, for some reason, goes to this tension between this rock and this tree. So if I go back in on my settings, I zoomed it out. So it kind of leads you in from the right side directly to the person and up this slant. And the Milky Way is going to add more of that leading line going on there. But I'm not going to go over all these global adjustments for time's sake, and I want to get into the real meat, the actual Photoshop work, but I play around with just global adjustments in Lightroom. And once I'm done with that, and you'll notice that I don't do a lot in the color portion here, because that has to happen when I have the sky in so I can best match the colors of the sky to the foreground. So I would just point out that save your like real color work for Photoshop. So we're going to start by right clicking our thumbnail and edit in open as smart object in Photoshop. And it's really important to open it as a smart object because you keep all your edits from Lightroom and you can make micro adjustments to them. So here it goes in Photoshop. And if I double click down here on my little thumbnail, all my edits that I did in Lightroom are all right here. So if I need to readjust just something very small, like it's a little too dark or anything like that, I don't have to start over from scratch. It's all right here. Versus if I just edit in Photoshop, it'll be a flattened image with my, well, not flattened, a raw image, but it'll be with my adjustments, but I won't be able to go in and readjust these things. I'll have to start from point one, so to say. So very important.
And just so you feel like you don't feel like there's no one responding and it's just like the silent audience that you're teaching, I'm right here and I'm also going to interject with my oohs and ahs. So when you hear that, don't be surprised.
So I actually opened up my, I just wanted to show that trick from Lightroom to Photoshop. I have my sky dropped in here behind, and you can see I did a little Photoshopping down here in the corner, but we'll go over that in a second. But so this guy was not shot directly. It was shot in Joshua Tree at the same time. However, it wasn't shot at this specific location because again, you can't be there at night unless you have a special permit. So it's really, and that's really why I do composites most of the time, is because for some instance, or maybe I just don't want to wait all night at that specific spot. I got other things to do. So in this case, it was because I couldn't be at this spot and leave my tripod in the same place. So let's dive in. I also want to point out when I edited, I also, you don't have to worry about the sky here. I just brought out the little person, my friend Ingrid down here.
That's not
so
you,
that you
could
see her. No, she's wearing my jacket though. I had her climb the rock for me.
That's nice. Yeah, go higher. Just keep going. It'll look better.
Yeah, I have some great stories from then. little rock climber. So basically what we're going to do, so we have our blue hour in Photoshop and we want to mask out the sky, and I want to mask it out as quickly as possible. I don't want to spend hours and hours doing this mask if I can help it. So the way I do masking is I start off with my channels and I'm going to look through my red, my green, and my blue channel. And what I'm looking for is the sky to be as white as possible and the foreground to be as black as possible. So there's as much contrast as possible between the foreground and the sky. So in this case, and in most cases, it's usually the blue channel. And as I click through these, you can see that the tonal value between the sky and the rock here is kind of similar. Same with the green channel, but the blue channel, all of a sudden the sky's a lot lighter. So great, we're gonna work with that. So I'm going to click, hold down Command or Control for my PC users and make a selection of this channel. I don't wanna work directly on this channel because it will affect my actual image. I'm just using the channel to create my mask. So by doing that, I'm selecting anything 50% gray or brighter and creating a new alpha channel with this little rectangle. Oops, I created two. Rectangle with this circle in it. So once I'm on this alpha channel, I can go ahead and deselect that selection. And I'm going to create further contrast between the sky and the foreground by using image adjustments and levels. I'm going to drag this little white one and this little black one in and watch what happens. My sky gets much more white, which is exactly what I want. And my foreground gets much darker. So we already have a pretty good mask here, but this Joshua tree is going to give me issues. Normally, if I didn't have a tree in here, I could just go and click the quick selection tool, which is right here, a little paintbrush with the little dots, and draw along my horizon line, and it will select the sky. But since I have this tree here, it's obviously missing pieces between the branches and everything like that. I can zoom in so you guys can see it. So it's kind of outlined the tree. So I don't want my blue hour sky to show through these trees. So I have to go about it a different way. And in order to do that, I'm going to use my paintbrush, just a plain old paintbrush, and my white. I'm going to switch it to white and make my paintbrush a little bit smaller using the bracket keys. And then I'm going to change this blending mode up here to overlay. Now, what this is going to do, since I'm painting with white, anything 50% gray or brighter will be painted white, whereas anything 50% gray or darker will be left alone. So I want to go just quickly around this Joshua tree and along my horizon line, just to make sure that I have a nice, crisp line between the sky, and it's either black or white. And once I I'm going to do the same thing with black. So you'll notice here especially where Ingrid is standing, I have a little bit of gray, and this is not going to do well for my mask. So I'm just going to click in and make sure I get that all good to go. And I can go over these plants here, and everything else looks good. Maybe bring back a little bit of these leaves in this tree. There we go. So once I've done that, I want to make sure that my mask is completely black and completely white, so I can just click on it and it'll select the sky. So I have to color in these, and it's easier to do that if I have it on normal black. Just make my brush nice and big and make sure I get everything in here black. And then there's a little piece up here closer to the horizon line, so I have to make my brush smaller so I don't go into the horizon line. I'm just painting in the rocks. And it looks good. So now the next thing I need to do is fix up this gray in the corner. So I'm gonna change it to white, make my brush nice and big, again, still on normal at 100% opacity, and paint that in. And this is just really just cleaning up the mask. So, and that looks good. So now I have a mask that's completely white and completely black. I'm going to command click this alpha channel again, or control click for PC. And now it's selected my sky and my only my sky. And you can see down here, when I zoom in, if you can see the little marching ants, they're here, but it's in between the tree branches. It's a little hard all over the internet, but you can now they're in between those tree branches. So very, very quick, very easy. So for those of you, a lot of times my biggest complaint is, oh, it's going to take me hours to be able to do this. Well, I just did it in 5 minutes, and I know I'm a little more experienced, but super, super simple steps. So once we have a selection, I want to expand the selection a little bit by like a pixel or two, because if I just put this on as a mask on my blue hour foreground, I'll end up with a thin blue line between my foreground and my sky right along the horizon, kind of where the marching ants are. And we don't want that. So we're going to go select, modify, expand. And we're going to expand it only by 1 pixel in this case, because I have a tree. If I expand it by 2 pixels, which is what I normally do with just rocks, it'll actually cut into the tree too much and it will look strange. So we want to just expand it by 1 pixel because of this tree, 1 pixel. And then I don't want that to be a super harsh line. I want a little bit of feather to it. So I'm just going to go right into the select, modify, feather, and do that by 1 pixel as well. So now that I have my mask selected, all I'm going to do is on my blue hour foreground layer, I'm going to hold down option or alt for PC because I want it to imply an inverse of the mask, white reveals, black conceals. I don't want it to conceal the foreground. I want to conceal the sky. I can also do this by just inverting the selection, but it's just easier in one click. So hold down option or alt for PC and click. And now all of a sudden we have our Milky Way with our foreground. Very, very simple, very quick, right? And there's going to be times where it's a little more complicated, especially with snowy mountains or a lot of trees, it tends to be complicated, but I find that paintbrush with the overlay is really, really important and really quick. So if I zoom in here, you can also see that, of course, we can see between the branches of this Joshua tree and the little bush down here. So,
awesome.
So one more thing that I want to do to this. So when we're looking at the night sky, naturally at the horizon line, there's some sort of light, and it can be light pollution from a nearby town, or maybe you're shooting closer to sunrise or sunset. So it's the fading light of the sun or the increasing light of the sun, so to speak. So naturally, there's generally some sort of light at the horizon line. So I want to kind of imitate that and create a little bit of separation between my foreground and my sky here. So what I'm going to do to that is create a new layer. And the new layer is going to be sandwiched in between my existing layer. So I have my foreground layer, my sky layer, and this new layer sandwiched down there. And so I want to use my gradient tool. And I want to make sure mine's already set up this way, but if it's not, you can click this little down arrow here and make sure it's going from color to transparent. That's the one you want. And we're going to select using our little foreground color and our little picker. We're going to select something close to the horizon line. Now, this is going to be, of course, way too dark. So we just brighten it up and we desaturate it a little bit. So we have a tiny bit of color. In this case, it's kind of like a purpley color. So we have a tiny bit of color, but it's mostly desaturated. So
I'm
we click
shocked you went with purple. I don't know why you would have purple.
I don't know. Usually that's just how it ends up.
Somehow your biases show through.
Yeah, pinks and purples. You would think that's my favorite color, but my favorite color is actually yellow, ironically.
Wow. Wow, you really treat purple well for loving yellow so much.
Yeah. So I'm going to create a gradient layer, and I'm going to start off by in the middle, holding down shift and just drag up. Now I'm going to drag this much taller than I would actually have it. And it's obviously much brighter than I would actually have it. We don't want to leave it here. The first thing I'm going to do is change the blending mode from normal to soft light. And that already softens it. But I go so far up because then I can bring it down to like where I want it to be. And I kind of want it to be, I know I want it to be behind my friend here, and I want it to be behind the tree. So it's creating that separation, but I don't want to go all the way up here because now we're washing out the whole Milky Way. So I'm going to drag it to about like here. So we have a little bit of glow here. We have a little bit of glow there, and I can stretch down the bottom. So that's not such a harsh gradient, like I'm stretching out the gradient a little bit. And once I do that, just change the opacity. My favorite number to use in all my editing, and you'll find this out, is 77. I use it for like everything. And so now we have our sky and our foreground all together, and we have the separation between the foreground and the sky. So it's not so much the same tones. So yeah, quick tip for putting your sky and your foreground together.
awesome. Now, you added that gradient there to add almost what seems like initially as a transition from the brighter foreground to the darker sky. It was just by virtue of blending those two time moments, you required to have that kind of glow. But it seems surprising to me that you actually added the glow after the fact. So what's your purposes behind that?
So I always add the glow after the fact, my first step, and I do the same things. And I don't know. I mean, I suppose you could add the glow when you're editing your Milky Way. You could do it then. I just like to have it as a separate layer for one, so I have a little more control over it versus it being combined with my Milky Way. And I go through the same steps for every single photo, same steps, edit it in Lightroom, cut out the sky, add the gradient, and then I move on to dodging and burning, then Orton glow, then vignette. So like, I just do it that way. You could do it prior if you wanted to. It's totally your call and workflow and stuff. That's just the way I've always done it. So it's not necessary.
I mean, to emphasize how good it's working. I mean, Mary Beth Kaczynski says, these are so cool. Royce Bear adds, Jess, I think the gradient near the horizon is so important to make the blend or the composite look more natural. Many people don't do this. And then Steven says, this just saved several of my past shoots. Thank you. So he's thanking you personally.
You're welcome. Agreed. I'm glad to help.
Also, I want to mention to you, Cheryl, that these are recorded. These links that you're finding in Facebook over on Royce Bear's Facebook page are always going to be active in the video section. You can watch the replay there, but also Royce Bear's YouTube channel. We've been uploading it there as well. So you have two locations that you can watch these replays. You can see last week's Brad Goldpaint, or you can watch this week's with Jess Santos. So you have those always available to you, Cheryl. And Thomas says, last week's video is still available. Oh, he's just answering Cheryl. Okay, awesome. So is there anything else you wanted to show us with your screen before we go back to a Q&A?
You know what? If we have time, I'll show you like a little bit of dodging and burning. Let's do that.
Let's do
because that's really fun too. And that, I believe, dodging and burning makes or breaks the image, to be honest. Like, it can add so much to it that you don't even realize. So I'm going to go through it a little bit quickly so we don't run out of time. But I'm going to create a stamped layer, Command Shift Option E, or Control Alt Shift E. It's pretty much all the buttons plus E. And what this does, is create a flattened layer for you to work with while leaving your layers before, if you ever need to go back and change anything. So it's really, really easy to go back and change and then just flatten the layer again. So once I have this flattened layer to work with, I'm going to duplicate that layer, just drag it down and create a copy. And then I'm going to use my level, similar to what we did in the masking, to just brighten it up. And I'm going to brighten it up way brighter than I think it should be. So I like to, where this histogram falls off down here, right at this little peak, that's usually where I tend to brighten it up to. And so I'm going to click OK there. Now, I'm not going to leave it like this, obviously. What I'm going to do is create kind of a mask to just show through the brightened image where I want it to, where the light is naturally falling in the image. So again, we're going to repeat the same steps. Go and click through the red, green, and blue channel. And this time what I'm looking for is the most contrast between where the light is naturally falling and where the shadows are. So red, green, blue, probably still my blue. They're very, very close, maybe red, because I have like lighter areas here and darker areas here I can work with. And I'm mainly looking at the foreground. I can use this in the Milky Way, but I tend not to. So I'm going to command click this and add a new alpha channel, just like we did with the mask before. And then again, I'm just going to create further contrast by using the levels. Drag in the white, drag in the black, and I'm just trying to get where the light is naturally falling here to be as white as possible, and it's not going to be completely what I'm looking for, but just get it as close as I can. And then I'm going to click OK. So now that I have this mask, I'm going to have to fix this area, but I kind of have this light naturally falling on these rocks, which is going to be my brighter areas in the image. And then the shadows are kind of really dark now, which is great. I want them as black as possible. So Once I have that mask kind of where I want it, I can command click again and apply it as a mask to my layer. So if I click on and off this, you already notice that it's already doing the dodging for me. Now the Milky Way is a little too overdone, so all I have to do is take my black paintbrush, painting with black, white reveals, black conceals. So I wanna conceal this part. And I don't wanna actually start off at 100%. It's easier to kind of add it over time. And I just paint right over here, just to kind of make that not so much. So click on, click off, I can do more. I can even up my opacity a little bit. It's really good in here.
It's always intense to see the before and after and how much
it's changed. Yeah, and again, very simple, just using the channels for masking. And so click on, click off, and you can see the difference. I can even darken this a little bit. And this is the part where you could spend hours if you wanted to fine tuning this. And this is where the real magic happens. I can switch over to my white and maybe paint in these shadows at a low, or these highlights, sorry, at a lower opacity, give them a little bit more depth. And I'm only working with the light where the light is naturally falling. I'm not adding any additional light. I'm just enhancing what's already there. And I think that's very important to make it look more believable, but it also gives a lot of dimension to your images. So there you have it.
Just say it perfectly. Mary Beth said it. This is pretty darn powerful. That's pretty fantastic.
Yeah. Simple tool, and just paint away until your heart's content. Like, really, this is where I spend most of my time, in this dodging layer.
That's awesome. And we have as much time as you have if you wanted to jump out or anything, but there's a few questions that might be wanting to be asked right here. And so those of you who are hanging out with us right now over there in the chat, if you have questions specific about what she has just done, let's ask some of those questions now while she can point out the things that are on her screen. When you're looking at this image right now, as you know, the changes have happened, you've added some highlights just by simply going in and choosing it like a luminosity mask. You see that there's one thing that's absolutely clear, and that's what I want to emphasize to everybody, and I want you to emphasize on and add any points too, is that the only reason why this works is because her foreground is not a disgusting mess of noise. And why isn't it? She said blue hour. So when you thought about doing this kind of post-processing, have you ever even done it with anything but blue hour?
No, I mean, I do it with sunrise and sunset, of course, but I haven't, quite honestly, since I started using this technique and any of these techniques, I completely did away with single shooting. Just blue hour is my main focus. It's my love and what I love to create. So I haven't even tried it on a single shot, to be honest. I mean, you're welcome to, but once you pump up that exposure and the levels, you're going to introduce a lot more noise than you're expecting to. So it might become difficult in that area.
Basically, blue hour or bust when you're trying to do this technique.
Yeah.
Fair enough. I have a few points that are coming through. Andrea says, I'm going to have to watch this again, but it seems simpler than using luminosity mask to make a mask. Wow. She is loving the simplicity of it. Bill has asked this question, and I'm curious what your thoughts are, because I haven't played around with the tool yet in Photoshop, but there's a sky replacement button now. Have you ever tried to make the composite with a sky replacement button?
I haven't. And I think that's relatively new, because one of our clients on the past workshop was talking about this. So I haven't gotten a chance to try it out, and maybe it might be quicker, might be easier. I don't even know that my Photoshop is updated to even have it, to be quite honest. You could also, so a lot of people use luminosity, like masking panels. You could do that to do this, because what we are doing is creating luminosity masks. We're just doing from scratch. We're not using a panel. And I tend to like to work that way. I feel like I have more control over it versus using automated features. That's just my personal preference. So no, I haven't tried the sky replacement, but you're welcome to try it. It might work great.
Yeah, there's no reason not to. Both could be something that works great. Yeah. A question from Stanley Harper. Do you use any luminosity panels like Lumensia? Did you just answer that? Do you ever use them at all?
Yeah, no, I've never used them. I do want to try Lumensia. I've heard really, really great things about it. And I've seen my friend Josh use it a lot. And it kind of, there was certain things that stuck out to me that were great to use the luminosity or the panel for. I've just always done it this way, the old fashioned way, I guess.
The old fashioned way that is technologically advanced for most of us watching.
Yeah, not technically the old fashioned way, but not using a panel. So. Yeah.
So then people are making comments left and right about how I learn something new every time from a new Nightscaper or presenter. And even Royce is saying, just when I think I know it all, even I am getting more information each time. So thank you so much. Huge thanks from everyone so far. Rob says, can you talk about the Orton effect?
Oh, the Orton effect. Yes, I use that. I can do a quick demonstration if you want, because again, it's a really quick thing. And since I'm here, so normally in my workflow, I start off with the Lightroom, bring it into Photoshop, replace the sky. I do this dodging and burning for a little while, and then I do the Orton effect. So I do that by, again, stamping a layer. My E key just came off. Command shift option E. I press that button a lot. Yeah, it's been coming off all the time. I just stick it back in there. So I duplicate that layer. I stamp that layer. Then I duplicate it. And then I create a blur. So it's a filter, blur, Gaussian blur. And this is going to depend, this radius is going to depend on the megapixels of your camera. So I'm using the Sony a7R IV. So that's about a 61 megapixel camera. So the number is 61 here. If you're using R3 or whatever, you just put the megapixel number in there. Click OK. And now we have an Orton glow, right? No, just kidding.
There it is. Perfect.
So again, we're going to go over to the channels. And what we're going to do is command or control click this RGB channel. And what this is doing, and in a night photo, you're going to see a very little selection, a very small selection. What this is doing is selecting anything 50% gray or brighter, because we want to apply that blur just to the highlight. So you can see this tiny little selection here. There's more in the selection, and I'll show you the mask after I apply it. But I'm just going to apply this back in my layers, back on that layer. And you can see my mask and my blurry, but you can see these gray and white areas. So it is showing through all the highlights. Anything 50% gray or brighter, this blur is being applied to. Anything 50% gray or darker, it's not being applied to. So it's still a little blurry, especially where my friend is here, right? Like, that doesn't look great. So all we do is change the blending mode from normal to my favorite, soft light. And now you have your Orton effect. So I know a lot of people do it differently, or different ways. There's a whole bunch of ways to do the Orton effect. This has just been my favorite way because I feel like it kind of wraps the light around and creates this dreamy little crescent of light in your images. And then for me personally, and this is completely up to your taste, let me move our faces out here. I like to apply a curves layer after, because I don't like the really contrasted look as I've mentioned before. And that's why I started going into blue hour blends and composites with blue hour, is because I don't like the contrasted look of light painting or low level landscape blending. So I apply a curves layer after I do my Orton glow. And on the RGB, I just bring the shadows up a little bit. It's just really easier to just click that button and type in the number 3. It's anywhere between 2 and 4. And then I do the same thing with the blue to add a little bit of blue to the shadows, a little cooler tone to the shadows. And that's usually 2 is my magic number for that.
So I want to emphasize real quick, go back into that panel. If you guys are watching the stream, it would be hard to see. She's talking about those little flags at the bottom of the row there. She clicked on that and then it allowed her, or did you click on the dot on the line?
The dot, not the flag. Yeah.
Then you get the output option that shows up, and then you can change that, you know, by manually with the numbers. Okay. Awesome.
Yeah. And it's also easier to fine tune it down there. I mean, I could drag it up, but me getting to 3 takes a lot. So it's easier for me to just type it in.
Yeah, I hear you. You go back and forth forever.
Yeah. And so this part is completely preferential, because I find a lot of clients, like, they're either one way or the other. They like the soft, dreamy look, or some people like the contrast look. So that's really personal preference there. So you can see the difference if I click it on and off. It's just a little bit softer.
Once you use the Orton effect, do you find yourself having to use it in every image?
Oh yeah, it's in every image. Stars, sunset, sunrise, every image. It really, really pops everything and creates this dreamy look.
It's really hard to go back. Everyone who wants to get involved in this, not only will you have to plan your compositions around being available in the blue hour and then wait for the nighttime shot to get your night sky there, but you're also going to have to learn Photoshop skills and blending the sky with the ground. And then it's going to look so amazing that you're not going to have another image after that that you'll do any other
way. Once you do blue hour, you're not going to want to go back. Or chances are. I don't guarantee it, but I got stuck.
Awesome. Well, let's go ahead and get rolling into our Q&A session. You can go ahead and kill your screen. Or did you have anything else you wanted to share real quick? Because I do want to bring up that people need to learn from you and do these kind of techniques. If you come to my workshops, I'm going to teach you the absolute basics a beginner needs to learn. I'm going to make sure that you go from never done it to this is looking awesome. But then there's so many more levels and tiers that you can go up. And one of those tiers that you can go up to is a workshop with Miss Jess Bess. And so I want to give you a chance to let us know if there's any workshops that are happening. Do you need to use your screen to show anything? It'd be awesome if you had something.
I mean, I could just show you my website.
Yeah, please. Let me go ahead and show you there. Let's do it. So
Go ahead.
I was just going to ask if you had anything available this year still.
Yes, I do have a few spots. There are like one or two spots on every workshop that are available. So my next one coming up is Death Valley. And that's in April, so it's a little bit close. It's like starts April 4th. So last minute, if you want to come to Death Valley, you're welcome to. The first week is still available. The second week is sold out. But after that, right before the NightScaper Conference, I have my Utah Badlands workshop. And it was previously full, but someone jumped to Death Valley instead of Utah. So there is one spot available for that one. And then after the NightScaper Conference, I have Joshua Tree with my good friend Kenny LaRose and Ryan Oswald. So there's three of us out in Joshua Tree messing around among the trees and the rocks and a lot of my favorite stuff. And then after that, Sierra. So I have a workshop with Joshua Snow in the Eastern Sierras, and we're going pretty much from Alabama Hills all the way to Mono Lake. And that's awesome. June 8th through 13th. There are, I believe, two, maybe three spots available on that one. And then I have another Utah Badlands in July with Kenny and Ryan again. I believe there's like one or two spots available on that one. And that's it. The other one is New Mexico, but that's sold out right now currently. So.
Ah, too bad. So there's a few spots left. If you guys are thinking about jumping in and joining her, you better act fast and get in there and join. And if you're thinking, okay, I probably can't put out money right now for the entire situation with the workshop, but I do want to learn a ton, well, right here. Go down to nightscaper.com. You can go down there, click up that, and join us virtually over at the NightScaper Conference. It's going to be May 10th through May 12th. And Miss Santos, Jess is going to be presenting. I'm going to be presenting. There's about 1,700 other people presenting that are going to be there, I think somewhere around 40. And it is going to be a fantastic beginning of the week, three-day hangout, learning Milky Way photography. So please come join us out there at the NightScaper Conference. So let's get involved into a little Q&A with Jess. And so if you guys have asked a bunch of questions specifically about technique, if you have anything that you want to ask her, any questions at all, if you're curious maybe about just how she got into it, or maybe, okay, if you're doing composite and you're going to blend in these two moments, do you keep your tripod still? Do you do this? How do you use your tracker? Any question whatsoever that might come to you, hit us up and make sure you use an all caps question over on the Facebook Live. That's going to help myself see which one is a very brand new question, and I can pop and present it to Jess and we can hang out and talk about that. So let's go ahead and do that for a few more minutes while we have you, Jess, and I'm going to bring you back into the scene. So hey, I'm your shoulder angel right now, hanging out next to you. It's all full screen.
Are you going to tell me good things or?
If the bad thing is that shoulder, then I'm on the bad side. So.
Oh, shoot.
It's like in one of my favorite Disney cartoons was the one with the Emperor's New Groove, where it's like Kronk is talking to his shoulder angel and he's like, I'm going to take you down the path that rocks. He's going to try and lead you down the path of righteousness. I said that in reverse if you know the quote well enough. But you guys hit me up with questions over here in the chat. I'm going to start with my own. when you're doing the blue hour shots, do you ever move your tripod, and what are your philosophies on blending versus composite?
So I do a lot of compositing, and I started off only doing blue hour blends. Like, I was strictly like, I want to wait out here and get the shot from blue hour to the night sky, or in the night sky to blue hour. Mm-hmm. And eventually I got to a point where I felt like it actually enhanced my experience instead of sitting out there shivering in the cold or the heat or whatever by myself, to take my blue hour shot, go back to the car, have a snack, set up my tripod and shoot the sky. Like, so I'm sitting there on the same night with the same sky and I don't have to suffer through it. At first I wanted to suffer through it, but now really it's just enhanced my experience to just enjoy nature like that. So I do a lot of compositing, and I'll always on my posts, if I put blue hour blend, or blend, it's a blend where my tripod stayed in the same place. If I put composite, my tripod moved at some point. It doesn't mean it was necessarily shot on a completely different night. It could have been the same night, but just up at the car versus down in the dirt. So
down in the dirt.
Yeah. So I do both. It just depends on what mood I'm in, who I'm shooting with, especially if I'm by myself. I like to go back up to the car, honestly. But yeah, it just depends on my mood at the time. And it also depends on the scene. For example, the Joshua Tree one I showed tonight, again, you can only go there and shoot night sky if you have a permit. It's a day use only area, so you can't use it after sunset or before sunrise. So even my blue hour was shot at sunrise because I couldn't be there at night. So that had to be a composite if I wanted that shot. So,
gotcha. One of the questions coming through is, do you use a tracker or a single stationary tripod?
So I use a single stationary tripod. I have used a tracker before, and I do like the look of a tracker. But I find that I'm just setting up. I'm doing what's called sky stacking. I stack my images for noise reduction. So I'm shooting on a tripod stationary at a very, very high ISO. It has to be above 10,000 for this technique to really work. And I'm taking about 25 images and then stacking together in a program called Starry Landscape Stacker, and stacking together 20 of them. And that virtually gets rid of all the noise that you're
real
getting
quick
at that high ISO, but leaving all the light and the detail.
Just go ahead and repeat that last line for a second. We just got a garbled version of what you said, so I want to not miss that point.
Yeah, so I'm shooting what's called sky stacking. I don't know where I cut out. So
you cut out just the last sentence about it.
Okay, so you're shooting at this high ISO, and when you stack them together, this high ISO introduces a lot of noise, of course. And when you stack them together, there's absolutely, well, virtually no noise. So you're getting all the detail and the light from the Milky Way without having to sacrifice for the noise. Okay. So, and it's a really clean image, especially with blue hour blends. You either want to use a tracker or you want to do stacking, because if you just shoot a single shot at like 3200 ISO, for example, you'll have some noise and then your foreground will have no noise. So then when you blend them together, it looks kind of strange. So you want to have a virtually noiseless sky to go with your noiseless foreground. So you kind of have to use one of those techniques.
Gotcha. Point from Royce Berry says, Jess, when you do your focus stacking for super close foregrounds, are you using the Helicon Focus app?
Yes. Yes. Helicon Focus. If you haven't tried it.
I haven't.
Saves your life. Oh my gosh. You'll never go back. You're like, where was this missing? Why was I missing this in my life? Like, it's so much more, it's a lot better than the Photoshop. I find that like the Photoshop stacking, sometimes like it misses areas and stuff like that. And you have to really go back and kind of do a little bit of surgery. And Helicon, more often than not, the only time it's had an issue is with flowers moving in the wind. But for all those Choya cacti and everything, it's just so much more precise to do it in Helicon Focus. So, personal favorite.
Awesome. Other questions about stacking, specifically whether you do, you've answered that. So let's ask this question. How many exposures do you usually tend to use in your stack for your Milky Way specifically?
For Milky Way?
Yeah.
So for Milky Way, I always shoot 25, but I use 20. And the reason I shoot 25 is if a car headlight flashes or I bump my tripod at the beginning or end, I still have those 20 to work with.
Smart.
But you can do it with as few as like 7 to 15 if you want. I just shoot with the A7R4. And because It has such a large sensor, or it's like the 61 megapixels. When you're shooting in low light, it's a lot more noisy than another camera. So I like to do a lot more and stack them together to really get rid of that noise.
Awesome. Rakesh asks, what's your favorite focal length for a Milky Way shot? Do you have one?
12 millimeter, which I know sounds strange. It's either 12 or 55.
You jump from that to that.
I know, it's one or the other. They're my favorite. I like 12, especially with the new Sony lens. It's like amazing. It's so beautiful. And then the 55, I use a 55 prime lens, and I really like when you can get the Milky Way in row right next to each other. It's just like, it really brings out the colors and you're that close up, and some scenes lend themselves really, really well to that focal length. So
right on. Royce Bear is helping with questions that came up in the past, some repeat questions. And the question was, the advantage of using blue hour blending is the lack of noise and the greater depth of field. So Jess, please confirm your starting exposure. Is it F11 ISO 100 30 seconds?
F11 ISO 100 30 seconds. That's usually where you start out with. You may have to adjust that depending on what you're shooting. If it's moving objects, obviously you can't do 30 seconds, but that's what I always start with, and then I'll adjust it as light increases or decreases.
So when you're doing that only for the foreground, I imagine, you're changing which element, just bringing the seconds down as you're adjusting? What are you adjusting?
So you'll start, it depends on whether you're shooting blue hour sunrise or sunset. So let's say we're shooting blue hour sunset, the light's diminishing. So I start off at a shorter shutter speed, like a quicker shutter speed, and I gradually increase to 30 seconds. And I find generally at the 30 second mark is when the light's perfect. There's this thing that happens, like a glow that happens. You kind of have to sit there and wait for it. And it's really beneficial to sit there and watch your scene sometimes, because the sun will set and then the landscape will get kind of blah, like monotone and no color. But then all of a sudden, as the sun gets to a certain point, I don't know why this happens or anything scientifically, but there's all of a sudden this really nice glow that happens. And usually when that happens, my shutter speed's at 30 seconds. So that's why I always say that's a really great baseline.
If you were to start at that exact point and start your focus stack there, do you think it's too late? Oh, we just lost your audio.
Yeah, generally, if you're going to shoot a focus stack, you want to start. Oh, can you hear me?
It was just delayed. I
moved
guess
closer
it froze
to the
for
computer
a second
up,
and then played your
helped.
Audio delayed. So that was it. So go ahead and answer that question again. Sorry.
So usually if you're wanting to focus stack, you actually have to start prior. And it also really depends on what you're focus stacking. Again, if you're focus stacking flowers, you're going to have to start right as soon as the sun is below the horizon. So as soon as there's no direct light on your scene, because flowers move, even if there's no wind, they move slightly. So you're going to want to start sooner. But if you're shooting something like Choya cactus or something and there's no wind and they're staying still, you can start a little bit later. But generally you want to start shooting as soon as the sun dips below the horizon, there's no direct light on anything in your scene, then you can start. And I would just keep shooting all the way up until it gets too dark.
Right on. Joe asks, do you use dark frames?
No, I don't. I probably should, but I don't.
I'm not sure if you should. I feel like that technique is going to be only a deep sky technique from here on out. I think the tech has changed enough that dark frames aren't common with Royce. They aren't common with me, and you don't do them. So, okay.
Really depends on your hot pixels. Like, I think dark frames are a lot more for hot pixels than anything else. And my sensor doesn't ever get hot enough, I guess.
Yeah. We don't shoot like long enough, and we aren't going crazy with it. And so usually you can just fix it in post if you have any at all.
Yeah.
Ken asks, are you using the Sony 12 to 28 lens, the 12 to 28?
12 to 24. It's the G Master, the one that came out like last year. I think it was late last year. 12 to 24 G Master f2.8, my dream lens.
Do you use it at f2.8?
I do when I shoot the sky, I shoot the stars, but I don't generally use it at 2.8 for landscapes, unless the light is just too far gone and I absolutely have to.
Gotcha. Yeah.
Denise
asks, what is the exposure for star stacking?
So my personal favorite is f2.8 because that's my lens. If your lens goes lower than that, you can do lower. So f2.8, ISO 12,800 is my personal favorite. You can start at 10,000 if you're uncomfortable with that number. And then I use a handy dandy little app called PhotoPills to determine my shutter speed. So there's a part in PhotoPills called spot stars, and you plug in your camera, your aperture, and your focal length, and it tells you what shutter speed to go.
Yep, and that is perfect. Go with that MPF rule. Go with the MPF rule. Royce shares another question that came from before. I know you sometimes like to do forced perspectives, using 16 millimeter for the closest foreground and then blending maybe a 35 millimeter perspective for the far foreground. Can you explain this to others?
So basically, what happens when you shoot with a really wide angle lens is things towards the middle of your frame tend to look really small. And you can get around this by just shooting with a wide angle and tilting it down, and you can stretch those elements, but sometimes that's not enough. So therefore I would shoot the foreground at 16 millimeters to really get whatever's in my foreground popping out at you and looking like it's coming out of the camera to grab you. And then the mountains, usually it's mountains that I'm doing this with. The mountain will be shot at say 24 or 35 millimeters so that it's nice and prominent in the scene, but not taking up the whole thing, and it's not too little. So it's really, really based on your composition. If you need to do this or want to do this, but it's the idea that you're shooting really wide in the foreground and then you're zooming in a little bit, not too crazy. Usually it's 24 millimeters or 35 max. So, and shooting, and then you blend them together in Photoshop.
And is that any more of a challenge to composite than put it in the sky around your foreground subject?
It depends on how you shoot it. It's really important when you're going into it. That gets a little more complicated as when you're thinking through, again, what your image is going to look like at the very end when you're post-processing it. This is where you really, really have to have this clear idea of how you're going to do that. Because when you're doing, I call them perspective blends. I've heard them call, I forget what the other term is, but basically where the line is, where your wide angle shot and your zoomed in shot are going to come together, you kind of have to have like almost nondescript space there. So like dirt or like bushes, like something that's, we can't have trees at that point because you're going to have a really difficult time masking around those trees and making it look real. So it's just thinking through how you're going to put it together and where that point is where your foreground and your midground are going to collide.
Absolutely. All right. Looks like we've got a great last question before we go. Oh, we've got two good questions coming in. Let's ask this one from James. When shooting during the blue hour, what white balance range do you use?
Okay. So this is really, really important.
Okay.
Very, very important. Never use auto white balance. First and foremost, never use it. You're usually in Kelvin. You're usually around 4,000 to 4,500. I am a Sony shooter, so I have a special little white balance for all my Sony shooters that I like to use. It's called Day White, and it's in the Sony menus, like where you have shade, cloudy, that, all that. It's down at the bottom. So I use Cool White for my skies because it's blue, and then I use Day White for my foregrounds, and this is because it's like blue, but it's a little bit of magenta. So it creates this kind of royal blue versus a more cyan color blue. And that's where I get the continuity out of my work, where I'm having those purple and those pink tones, is because I'm shooting at the same white balance every single time. So.
And that's where the purple comes in. It's not a branding choice. It's just it's just an outcome from what you're choosing.
Yeah, it kind of started as I chose that white balance. I liked it. And then I just continued on with it. Like, shoot what you like. If you like more of that cyan blue, really go with that and create this continuity throughout your work so that when people look at your work, they know it's you. And you can really do that with color. So.
And always remember that when you're capturing the Milky Way in the night sky, it's going to be our own artistic interpretation all the time of what the sky looks like. It's not going to be perfect to the science of the sky. So don't get caught up in that. Just get, you know, represent what you like. Choose your favorite.
Yeah.
Cheryl asked, for the forced perspective blend, do you do a pano when you do the 24 to 35 millimeter?
So I tend not to have to do a pano because I set it up that way in camera. So if you turn on your third grid lines, the easiest way to do it is your top third, like that line should be where your foreground is going to meet your midground. So if you're shooting a mountain and some cacti in front of it, for example, you're going to have the cacti end at that top third and the mountain start at the base of that mountain be at that top third. So I kind of line it up that way. But again, it's practicing and it's really knowing how it's going to look when it's a final image to really get those things. So,
gotcha. Bill asks, could you use a two-shot multiple exposure in camera to help visualize the perspective blend?
I'm sure you could. I haven't, but I'm sure you could.
Yeah, why not? Carl Reese says, wow, Jess, those tips using the RGB individual channels for masking is invaluable. Thanks heaps. So yes, thank you a lot. And then looks like, let me go ahead and take it right back to me for a moment. And we're going to come back in with the final word. And we're going to ask the last few questions of our guest tonight, Jess Santos. And so let's get rolling with that. And all right. Oh, Royce, looks like I just gave something that is going to be the worst. Let me just go back to that real quick. It looks like something fell apart on this scene where we have no display for you. So right now we're going to go into our final word with Royce Bear. And Royce Bear comes to us over here on Zoom like we have been. He's right here in the group. Hey, Royce, welcome in.
Hey, how you doing, Aaron?
I'm doing
How are you well. Doing, Jess?
I'm doing good.
So then, Royce, with your listening of everything, I mean, let's see, you're not seeing me. I'll fix that here in a second. But with everything that you're hearing from Miss Jess Best, you said even you have learned some stuff. Is there anything that stands out that you went, oh, yeah, I could do that?
Well, there wasn't anything specific, but I just learned something new from every person. And even if I only learn one new thing, it's worth the time spent. Don't you agree?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, when you think about those who are coming to the NightScaper Conference and joining us, we have thousands of tips from just the peers around us, let alone the people who are going to be presenters at the conference. And so we really can't lose there at all.
You know, the reason I brought up the forced perspective is that I've done that a little bit, but I've seen Jess use it quite a bit. And I think she's refined that more than I have. Thank you, Jess.
You're welcome.
But I wanted to talk for just a minute about, you know, a person brought up the color balance. And you have said before that, you know, the worst thing you can do is put your camera on auto color balance. And I see, because they think, well, I can correct this later on. You know, I've got the raw files, I can correct that. But you pointed out that the reason you go for your rich royal blue, as you call it, is for continuity.
Yeah.
And I love that thought. It's your branding. It's your photo vision. It's your art. I like what you said. So when people look at my work or at your work, they know it's you.
Yeah. And I get that comment quite often is a lot of people are like, oh, I was just scrolling and I knew it was your work. Like I'll see that comment all the time on social media and stuff like that. So it's really about creating continuity, but you have to start with something you like. Like, don't just do something for the sake of doing it. Do what you like and then continue with that. Once you find something you love, like the colors or whatever the case may be, just continue with that.
Yeah, agreed. And don't do it because you want to be popular. Ooh, I saw something that I like and I want to be popular.
Yeah.
You know, it's got to resonate with you in the beginning.
Yeah.
And then make it your own. And you've done that. There may be some people that disagree with your color balance. I can think of a few scientists that I know of that would say that is not the real color of the Milky Way or the night sky. Who cares?
Yeah. I mean, and that's the beauty of art. Like, we're creating art here. I like to think of photography as the art. I think we're past just having to be journalistic and photograph exactly what's there with no alterations or whatever. I'm creating art and just creating what I like. And so I think, do you, if you like that, do it. If you don't like it, don't do it.
Right. There's no reason to have those kind of pressures where you're already beating yourself up for your quality of image. If you get sucked into all the people who might be naysayers or haters of your work, then you just can get bogged down forever. There's always going to be people who might not like what you're doing, but there's going to be the same amount or 10 times as many people that love what you're doing. And so you just got to celebrate what you love to do the most and do that and enjoy it.
Yeah. And you can definitely appreciate other art, others' artwork that may not be the way you might shoot something, but I appreciate so much art that I wouldn't shoot it that way, but it looks beautiful and it looks great. And that's the beauty of creating artwork, really, is us being able to express ourselves through the lens and through the tools we have available.
Well, Jess, we're excited to see you and what is it, about 45 more days that we'll be able to... We're going to hear you again and with more detail. And I hope those that are viewing will come to the NightScaper Conference. If you need more information, just go to www.nightscaper.com and it'll give you the details. Unfortunately, you're not going to be able to come in person. We have a limit of 150 people that can come in person. And most of those are from the previous 2020 canceled conference. They held on to their tickets, about half of them did. And so those people are getting to come in person, but you'll be able to come virtually. We've hired a video production crew at a cost of about $30,000. They're going to try to make everything as live as possible. And then they're going to archive it to the cloud. You'll be able, within a day or two, you'll be able to replay and replay and replay to your heart's content for up to a year. You'll be able to see Jess Santos in living HD 1080p. Yes, I love that. Can they take some of the wrinkles off of here?
Hey, they sound like a very high-tech group. They should be able to do that, right? You're just going to have to wear one of those body suits and draw all those markers on your face so they can put the CGI over you.
That's all I have, Aaron. Let's go ahead and close it up for the evening.
On. Well, to end this, I just think just quoting Mary Beth Kaczynski would be fantastic, as she is already a fantastic photographer. And here she says to Jess, you know, like, I think once you get past that, meaning that part about hating people who hate your work, people who have critiques of your work, if you get past those criticisms, it's easier. Like you did, Jess, and she says, I love your work. And I am definitely hyper jealous of your work, and your work really distracts people from ever wanting to look at my simple single image photography. No. No one wants to follow me on Instagram when there's people like Miss Jess Bess out there. This is why you're doing so well. You're doing awesome, and I think it's going to be fantastic to meet you in person. I can't wait for the conference. I hope that all of you who are here hanging out right now have gone and told either friends or family that are lovers of photography, or done it yourself, or you've gone to nightscape.com and join us for virtually in the conference. And so that's going to be a blast. He says 45 days away. Away. Oh man, we get woot woot. Thank you from Vinay. Thank you from Steve Haddix. Thank you from Judy. There's tons of thank you. Thor says, this is right now, it's okay. We're at the crossroads of art and science. And so the sky situation with the colors of the sky, we're at the crossroads of art and science. So there's no problem with that. So thank you guys. Thanks everyone for joining us tonight and hanging out with us in the Nightscaper Conference pre-event. Royce, do we have any word about next week that we can share with everybody?
Gee, I've forgotten already.
The surprise will come today, or it'll be tomorrow or the next day, that you can check out on Royce Bear's Facebook page. If you're not following him already, just make sure you go to the page that you're on right now, click follow so you can get all the notifications and you can be alerted when we know who our next guest is. Jess, thank you so much. You've been a fantastic teacher tonight and a guest. Thanks for joining us. We really appreciate it.
Thank you so much for having me.
Absolutely. So everybody who's hanging out with us right now, thank you so much for sharing this video. Thank you so much for watching. And we'll be back next week with a whole nother Nightscaper Conference presenter. And it's going to be another blast, another learning lesson, and a thing that's going to make you want to go back and watch and replay and watch. And so just a reminder for those watching Jess's tonight, you can go back and watch this anytime and learn from some more from her. So thanks all. See you guys later. We're out of here.